In this session, let's look at the P&L statement of the company, what all it contains, and how do I assess the performance of the company from the P&L statement. So for this, I have directly taken one P&L statement of this company, Dr. Reddy Labs. The website of that company, anything which is a public listed company, every year they publish what is called as an annual report, which is mandatory to be published on the website. Anything which is a public listed company, which has got investments from the public, which is listed on any stock exchange, anything, India, US, wherever it is, which is listed on some stock exchange, mandatorily it has to publish the annual report and even the quarterly reports. So they are all present. If you go to the websites of those companies, you will definitely find an investor section. Under that, you will see at least for the last 5 years, the annual reports will be present. Minimum time they will be retained is for the 5 years at least. Some companies they present even for the last 20 years also. But at least 5 years is something you will definitely see there. And typically what is contained inside these, everything about the company, right? As an external guy, what all needs to be presented, right from the chairman's letter to the financial highlights. They talk something about the performance and all, because see, if I have purchased some shares of a company, or I want to purchase some shares of the company, I don't know anything about this company, right? I'm not an internal member of the company, I'm not an employee of the company, but I still want to put some money. Just like I have some money, I have to put in some business. Instead of starting my own business, I'm trying to put that money in some businesses which are actually running well, right? It's just like buying another FD, putting a money in an FD. It's just like buying some other bonds. Same. It's just another thing. Instead of putting my money in an FD with the bank, I'm saying I'll put my money with the company, right? If the company is able to generate some profit, probably I will get more return in a year. Rather than probably if I put in an FD, probably I may be getting some 8%, 9% return every year. Whereas if I put it here, it may so happen if the company is growing very fast, getting high profits, I may get more share of that profits. That's the intention of doing this. So some kind of financial highlights, key milestones, the various aspects like this are published in every annual report. Now, if we are able to read one good annual report of any company, every company will have, that gives a full knowledge about the whole business of the company. Even though you are not an internal member of the company, but you can understand the whole business of the company, the financial numbers, the P&L statement, the balance sheet, everything of the company is understood. Even if you see here, the human resources of the company, what are who are the key people in the company, what are the safety norms they are following, what are the corporate social responsibility activities they are into. So you get a big snapshot of the total profile of the company. Apart from that, who are the board of directors? Board of directors are the people who act on behalf of the shareholders. See, here, so many people are buying the shares of the company, right? And they have to get some profits. How will they get their profit if the company is using their money in the right path, right? What if they take the money and typically use it for wrong reasons? So there should be someone who has to protect the interests of the shareholders. Because shareholders don't get involved day to day. I have 25 company shares with me. I can't go to 25 companies and keep tracking them. Right? So there should be someone who is taking my responsibility and making sure that the company is doing its operations in the best interests of the investors only, because at the end, money is coming from the investors. Right? Generally also, every employee has to work as per the owner's guidelines. Right? Because money is coming from the owners. So a shareholder is also like an owner, only a small owner, but he's the owner. Right? So the every decision that is taken within the company should be in line with the investors, investors' expectations. So that is what as a person, I have to see who are these guys. Are there any fraud people on the board? Right? Probably someone who has been arrested on some grounds earlier, or on whom some cases were there earlier. Are those kind of people there? Or some very trustworthy, honest people are there on the board? They need not be members of the company at all. Right? A professor of some business school can be brought onto the board of some company. It's only a matter of trust. See, these are very honest people. They are very much knowledgeable about the business. So they, if any fraud is happening in the company, they will try to stop the management. They can sense it very easily and they can stop the management from executing those kind of decisions. So probably if such kind of a person is there on the board, it's a matter of trust about that company. Oh, if this company, we have put a very honest person on the board of the company. So it's a kind of a trust in the investor's mind. Oh, this company has this kind of an honest guy on the board. So there is a good chance that this company will not do a big fraud. So looking at the board of directors, their qualifications, they're all present here. If I go to this page number 51, I mean, before I just get into the income statement, I would like to drive this. You see here, all the people, their profiles. So this one person or two people, they may be from the company. Whereas, you see here, Dr. Omkar Goswami, independent director. He has nothing to do with the business. He is an external person. So, a professional economist. He did his master's from Delhi School of Economics, blah, blah, blah stuff. Now, he also holds directorship in all these companies. You see his profile. He is with Infosys. He is with Crompton Greaves. So, he is like a person who acts on behalf of the investors. That is the key thing. He has to make sure every person who is a part of the board of directors, they have to make sure that every decision that the company is taking is not for their personal benefit. See, decisions are taken by the managers. The decision which a manager may or may not have any shares in the company, he may still be an employee of that company without holding any shares of that company also. But whatever the decision he is taking, is it in the best interest of the shareholders? Will it benefit the shareholders or will it eat away the benefits of the shareholders? That is what is the analysis which the board will do in every board meeting. Right. So you see, these are all independent directors. Mr. Ravi Bhutalingam. They are not anything to do with the company. So typically, the more the number of independent directors the company is having, the more is the trustworthiness that is existing with that company. Because these guys, they don't have big number of shares of the company. Right? Probably just like you and me, they may have some shares. Very few number of shares, but they are not influential kind of shares. Right? So these are more like they are specialists in their own areas who can lend some kind of knowledge about the performance of the company. Who can take the decisions very effectively about the company. You see, so many, very few of them are there who are the people inside the company. Right? Only the CEO and couple of them. They only belong to the company. But rest of all the board of directors are external guys only. So that is what we'll talk about, the strength. Right? So it's very much essential to understand who the board is for this particular company to before we can actually take a big decision about the investment. And finally, the most important thing for us is the financial statement. The financial statements which are present here. Okay. If I go to this financial statements, so they are presenting the balance sheet, the profit and loss statement, as well as the cash flow statement. So we'll look at the profit and loss statement to start, and the auditor report will be there, which will talk about, are these financial statements prepared in line with those standards or some violation of the standards is there. That's the major thing which an auditor report will contain, with a signature from who was the auditor. Right, probably if we read it, we can see that is there any kind of a fraud in any of the areas, or is there some manipulation in the numbers? But of course, even after everything is shown as everything fairly presented, suddenly some kind of a scam may break out, which means there could be some kind of deal between the auditor and the company. So he may very well publish that everything is fine. That's where the cases come against the auditors, that they are misusing their power. Because auditors typically have a very heavy power, because the moment auditor says this company's financial statements are not as per the standards, the reputation of the company is very badly lost. That's the power of the auditor. But so there could be some level of compromise between the various parties, right? Now, okay, this is the typical profit and loss statement of the company. You see here what all are included in this profit and loss statement. Few things. It is prepared for the year ended 31st March 2012. They are yet to publish it for the 2013, which it's in the process. It will come out probably sometime in this month itself. So for the year ended 31st March 2012, which means it is from April 1st to March 31st, April 1st, 2011 to March 31st, 2012. And they are also publishing a comparative value of the previous year. So this is one major thing for every financial statement. A previous year's value also need to be published, so that people can compare the things. Did it grow? Did it fall? These kind of things can very well be looked at. Now, the most important thing is, the first thing that this starts during the year, what is the sales? I'll increase the resolution a little bit. Sales. So otherwise, I have copied it into the Excel sheet. Let me show it from the Excel sheet. This is better. So the sales. There is something called gross, which means the total number of, it's like a total revenue for the company, which is more like number of drugs sold. See, this company is purely into selling various drugs. So number of drugs sold and the total price, total number of units sold into price per unit. That is what is the total revenue the company has got. It has not to do with the profit. So this company has got around 66,400, all the amounts are in millions. So 66,000 million, which is almost 6,644 crores. So this company, in this year, the total revenues of this company is 6,644 crores. Right? So this is the typical term which people use for turnover. The total turnover of the company is 6,640 crores. It's a total revenues. It's not profits. Turnover means it's not profit. It's a revenue. right? So when we say 20,000 crore company or 6,000 crore company, it's the revenues that are 6,000 crores for it, right? Then, so now probably it was like, so this is nothing but the total number of units, various drugs, so many medicines, different costs. It won't mention it in detail. The details are available to the extent. If you see here, sales, there is some notes. Here they did not put any notes. If there is some notes that they have put up, like some of these things, if you see, for other operating revenue, they have put up some notes 2.16. You go to that section 2.16, you will get a little bit of more details about it. Right? Probably other income. They just said other income is some money. Other income, they said around 1,196 million or 818 million for this year. 81 crores is what they said other income. But what is that other income? So they have given some breakup of it. You go to section 2.17. I'll take you there. You go to the 2.17. You'll know what is the breakup of that other income. But for sales, they did not give any notes, which means there is nothing more than that for us. So if you are an internal person, now this is where the difference between budgeting and financial forecasting comes. Because if I am an external user and my intention is to think how much profit will the company make next year, the only information that is available to me is at what rate the sales is growing every year. Probably for the next year, if I have to make my P&L statement, I'll just see, okay, from last year, they have grown, let's say, by some 20%. So probably next year also, if I look at it the same way, so next year also, I'll put one number for 2013, which is a purely a hypothetical kind of a number. Based on how I am seeing the company is growing, how the industry is growing, right, probably, okay, pharma industry, it's growing at a much bigger pace. So if it is growing at a much bigger pace, probably for the next year, you put my sales figure as another 20% increase over the current year. So that is what a financial analyst will do, who has access only to a limited set of information about the company, which is purely the external information. Now, from a management accountant standpoint, which is the focus is budgeting. There, you will have all details. How many drugs are there? How many units of each drug you have sold? What was the price of each of the drug? Right? When we do one small budgeting case study tomorrow, a very minuscule version I will take up, where 2-3 products, where you are trying to make the entire budget, you have all access to all information. Right here, you don't have any access. I don't even know what are the names of the drugs which the company is selling. Whereas as a management accountant or as an internal budgetary guy, you will have access to, when you are talking of sales, you will start right from, okay, what are all my products? How many units? What is the price per unit? What is my total revenue? So this is the framework that comes for the sales. Whereas in the financial statement, it's the final figure. In some cases, there may be a slight more detail in terms of notes, whereas in some cases, even that may not be there, right? Only the mandatory part is the sales figure. So probably all I can do is, I can see, okay, who are all the competitors of these guys, right? Cipla, how did it grow? Ranbaxy, how did it grow? Sun Pharma, how did it grow? So I can look at only from that standpoint. Yes, Ranbaxy is growing much lesser compared to Dr. Reddy's. So probably growth-wise, at least in the market share-wise, Dr. Reddy's is having a higher market share compared to others. So some kind of analysis will come out from that standpoint. So this is what about the revenues. This is gross. Now, every manufacturing company is exposed to some kind of excise duties, especially when you have some kind of exports. You are exposed to some kind of an excise duty, which is like a tax. This is one form of a tax, more associated with manufacturing and export-oriented organizations. For some of them, which are non-manufacturing, you may not see this number. But for most of the manufacturing organizations, that much. So for this company, it's almost 40 crores. They are paying in the form of excise tax. So after this, the net sales of the company is around 6,603 crores. So there is a mechanism that first you will put gross sale, which is the total units multiplied by the total total price per units kind of stuff. Arrive at the gross, which talks about the total turnover of the company. Then we are removing the excise duty from it. This is a standard template. Whether I prepare for Infosys or prepare for Dr. Reddy's or anyone, industry agnostic. Probably one or two items could be here and there, because this may be more into licensing and a couple of more things. So there could be a couple of items here and there. Whereas majority of the items are standardized. Right? So if you look at the same, net sales is nothing but after I remove the, because that tax for a service companies, we call it as service tax. Service tax, the way it is levied is, it is not levied on the profit. It is levied on the revenue. For example, this session I am taking for you, I have charged something from you. Right? If I have to, irrespective of whether I am generating a profit out of this or not, because I have charged some revenue from you, I have collected some revenue from you, I have to pay, let's say 12% of this as a service tax. Whereas the final tax, whatever you are paying, that is based on the profit. Income tax, when you say, the income tax is purely based on the profit. Whereas the service tax or even excise duties, they are not based on the profit. They are based on the revenues. So, irrespective whether you have generated a profit or not, when you have sold something, you have to pay a tax for it. Right? So that's where the actual sales for the company is only this much. Because that excess was just because that money has gone directly to the government. So, it is not even recognized as a sale by the company. So, the sales typically are being looked at this level. So, these are my actual revenues. If I remove the... So, these are also still the revenues part. Now, after that, it starts... from the other revenues... So, this is about the goods. The various goods it has sold or various drugs it has sold. Whatever the revenues it has got. And it also has got some service income. It offered some kind of... not just the products... It also had some level of services, consulting, advisory kind of stuff. Even there was some revenue from those. It has got some 53 crores in the form of the advisories or any other service what it is offering. It's not a production of, just not selling of the drugs. But apart from that, it has several other sources of generating the revenue. So that was what is the service revenue. And only for this year, this is only from the 1st April 2011 to 31st March 2012. Similarly, license fees. This is more specific to the pharma industry. Not all industries may be having a license fee. They have generated some money by giving licenses to various agencies. Right, they might have collected some kind of a license fee. So, the license fee for the year from various people is to the extent of 11 crores. That's also a source of revenue. And here, one thing. This is only for the year. If this license fee had been for more than a year, it would not have come under the P&L statement. Annual renewable license. If it is not an annual renewable license, let's say you have collected 11 crores and it is for 2 years, then only 5.5 crores will be shown here. It will be divided and it will be shown. So the remaining 5.5 crores, it should show in the balance sheet. It will show in the next year, but for this year, it will show in the balance sheet because it is outstanding. At the end of this year, it is still outstanding. So it should be shown in the balance sheet. That's the linkage. So if I say all 11 crores is applicable only for this year, next year they have to still renew. Everyone has to renew it. Then all 11 crores will be shown here and nothing in the balance sheet. Now, here, one important thing. 6,600 crores, right? 6,644 crores. This is what they have sold. Correct? Now, the key thing we have to understand here is, this need not be the cash which they have collected. Revenues are nothing to do with the cash they have collected. Reason being, when will you write it in the revenues is, it is not at all dependent on the cash collection point. The moment the change of ownership happens, or the moment the good is delivered. See, sometimes you may collect the cash in advance. Sometimes you may collect the cash later. You have given it on credit. Anything could be possible. Right? The moment you have delivered the good, rendered the service. Let's say I have given the session, but I would have collected the cash way before it, or I would be collecting 1 month later. It has nothing to do with the P&L statement. Any item, not just the revenue. This concept, again as a terminology, is called as accrual concept. It is nothing but simple way to understand. It's not a cash concept. Right? It is not a cash concept. It is called as an accrual concept. The point here is, the clear thing to understand here is, any item is getting incurred into the P&L statement based on the time of incurrence. When you actually earn it, see, even though you have collected, I have collected the cash in advance, right? The actual earning of that for me is when I really finish the work. If I don't finish the work, it's not that I have earned it, right? You have given the cash to me. It's like, until that time, I am still liable to you. Look at the flow. You have given me a cash in advance. I did not do the work for you. Until that time, I am liable to you. So if a balance sheet was prepared before that, cash received, but I did not do the work for you, it means from my side, there is still something pending for you. So it will go as a liability until that time. On that day, when I complete the work for you, it means it becomes my money. Right? It's not about when did I get the cash. It becomes my money when I really have earned it. It remains as a liability. So cash is nothing to do with the preparation of the P&L statement. So any income that is being shown here, or any a number that is being shown here, it's like that much of sales the company has done. How much of it is in the cash form? How much of it is in the credit form? No information. Right? And out of this, how much of it is received? See, credit also, some part of the credit we would have received by now, because this is for the whole year. Probably if I have sold something on credit in June last year, by July or August, they would have paid the cash also. Right? So, how much of it is collected out of this is not known. That is where a balance sheet entry will help me out with. That's where I said using the P&L and the balance sheet together, I can analyze the real cash movement. Because the P&L is showing that the company has made 6,000. Just if you understand this, it becomes very easy. The company has made 6,640 crores of sales. And I'll again come back to it. Here, there is something called receivables. Receivables is telling me 1,943 crores is yet to be received. Which means the company has collected the cash only for the balance. Getting this point? It has made a sale of 6,600 crores. But the P&L statement does not talk about the cash collection. So, if I have not collected the cash, where should it show me? It should show me in the balance sheet. See, if I had collected the cash, transaction is over. Nothing is outstanding. Just think of, I have sold something to you. Right? If I had collected the cash from you regarding that, no outstanding for anyone. For me, I have given you the good. You have given me the cash. Transaction over. Nothing is outstanding from anyone. But I have given the good, but you did not pay me the cash. It's like I have given you on credit basis. You did not give the cash to me. Which means this transaction is still pending. Outstanding. It becomes a liability for him. It becomes an asset for me. So to whatever extent I did not receive, that much money is my asset. Because I will receiving it in the next year. So to whatever extent that I have not received, I am showing it under this heading. So this is one form of an asset for me. Right? Because of the trade which I am doing, what is the receivables part? So there is a correspondence. So basically these two put together will tell me the total cash which I have collected from my customers. Right? How much sale did I make? Because P&L statement has nothing to do with the cash collection. That's one thing we have to be comfortable with. It's purely on how a sale is done. Whether you have really earned it or not. Real earning will happen when the work is over from your side. You may get the cash of it before or after. If you have got it before, until the time you finish your work, it remains as a liability to the other party. You are liable to the other party. To that amount of extent, to that extent of amount. If you have if you are going to receive it after you do the work, until you receive it, it's going to be your asset. Right? That's one important thing we need to see. So even when you are making a budget also, when you are making a sales budget, you have to look at from that perspective itself, because most of the transactions for most of the businesses, they involve credit. Right? Very rare that all transactions happen only on a cash basis. At least for bigger companies, that's not the scenario at all. There is a heavy thing that goes on a credit basis. So your receivables will typically be very, very high. In this case also, we have seen almost 1900 crores was a receivable. Right? Probably they will get it within the next 1 or 2 months. But it's because they always give some kind of credit periods. If they are selling some bulk drugs, bulk quantities to someone, the medical shop guys may say, right, let this medicine sell off. Then only we will give you the money corresponding to it. See, probably the medical shop may not pay money and buy all the medicines, right? The typical business model wise. So basically all these guys, they are stocking up the medicines there. And probably on a monthly basis or based on whatever the amount of sale that has happened, you see that they receive the cash for it. So that is where the receivables and sales gross put together will tell you actually what is the cash collected. Because we said cash is also a very important aspect in the business, right? Compared to, you see in the here, the same thing, service income, 530. But yeah, I mean, all these put together was what they have shown as a part of this receivables. It could be because of the service, it could be because of the product. Anything, almost all put together, 1,943 crores is yet to be received from my customers. Which one? See, if once this amount is received, the entry in the P&L is already over. It's only the cash that improves. Cash position improves. And this position will become zero. Receivables will become zero. Cash will increase. The reality will increase. Until that time, the reality is lesser by 1900 crores. Probably if I just see to that extent, my bank balance will show some 1900 crores lesser. As simple as that. Right? Though my P&L is showing 6600 crores, assuming no expenses, nothing, just sold. If I am selling 6600 crores, logically speaking, 6600 crores should be in my bank account also. But I will see only 1900 lesser. Right? Only the remaining amount is seen as of today. So cash and the P&L, there is a complete mismatch. The moment he pays that, so if I take these two things together, that is what should reflect my cash position. Only for this item. Same way for all the items. If I take all P&L elements, all balance sheet elements, the total is what, the net of it is what is my cash position. Right? So, yes. Then, the same thing. Okay, all these P's. This is what is incurred for the year. Incurred for the year means for this year the license fee is 110, 11 crores. Some of them might have paid it in advance. Some of them might still have to pay it. Right? You say you have to renew your license. If they don't pay it immediately, I will not cancel it off also. Right? Probably I will give, okay, extend it by one more month. Which means they still have to pay it. Right? So, in those cases, I'll still show it that it's a revenue, but I have still not realized it cash wise. So the most important aspect is while preparing the P&L, the most important aspect is I am not going by the cash concept. I am going by when it is simply earned. Simple, other better example for you, salaries, right? Salary for the month of March. March 1st to March 31st. The salary belongs to that month. But let's say the payment happens on April 5th. Which might be very much possible. Right? Or rent. Every monthly rent. Let's assume that I am paying it next month. Some deal. Probably it could be in advance. It could be later. Whatever it is. But salary, better example. You work for 1 month. Next month, first few days, you will get your salary. Look at it as a financial year. March 1st to March 31st. Salary for that period, for that financial year, you are receiving in the next financial year. Right? If I look at it as a year. Now, in the income statement, in the P&L statement, it would be shown as expense. Because that belongs to that period. It does not belong to the next period. But the payment wise, it did not happen. As of that 31st March, the payment did not happen. Which means from a company standpoint, that is a liability. Whatever is the March salary, that that expense, it still did not pay. So that much will be there in the liability in the balance sheet. So that is how you have to understand these two entities. Right? Here, it is purely based on when it is incurred. Is it incurred from during this period, April 1st to March 31st? Or is it incurred later or before that? Only for that year. So March, April salary, even though you have received it in March only, you will not show it in P&L statement. April salary, even though you have received it in March, you will not show it as an expense of the company there at all. It's like company has done some advance payment to you, which means it need not pay next month, which is like company's asset. It has done an advance payment to you. You still have to provide your services to the company for that amount. So, which means from a company's standpoint, that is also an asset, because it will get benefit from that in the future, in the next financial year. Getting it? So the incurring should be, so probably that's one aspect you have to be comfortable with. Whether I am showing it as a revenue or an expense, it's not based on the cash collection or cash payment. It's purely based on to which period is it applicable to. So even when you are preparing your budget statements also, this concept has to be followed. Because the budget income statement, budget P&L, balance sheet, the managements will typically ask for to present your budgeted statement, because they will be acting as targets for the performance measurement and all that. So from those standpoints also, there also you will prepare a similar kind of a statement. But as I said, the only thing is that is more detailed, more internal in nature, whereas this is more from an external standpoint. Similarly, other revenue. Other revenue, they are saying almost 71, other operating revenue, they got to the extent of 71 crores. Now for that, they have given some kind of a details. What is this other operating revenue? They have expanded it in section 2.16. So if I go down, they will explain. See here, each of them, they are explaining 2.1. Right, 2.2. So under 2.16, I can look at that aspect. Okay, this is 2.16. You see here. So they said sale of spent chemicals. So they sold some chemicals which they have spent. So they got some 38 crores out of it. Whether they received it or not is immaterial. That worth of the deal, they have struck the deal. The worth of the deal is 38 crores. And they have dispatched that chemicals to the other party. Whether they received the cash in advance or later, that's not considered. So for any income related, any revenue related stuff, The point to be considered is, did I complete my work? Did I deliver the good? That is the point where it gets treated into your revenue. Right? That's a simple thing. So if you have sold it, over. You may receive the cash, you may not receive the cash, you may receive the cash later. Doesn't matter. Right? Similarly, they are saying some scrap. They are selling off some scrap. So, like this, these are some of the things they are saying that they are selling, which is what is contributing to that other operating revenue for them. And similarly, so the total operations revenue for them is 6,739 crores, which is out of this 6,600 product sales, they even had some 53 crores of service income, 11 crores of license income, and some around 72 crores of other revenue. So overall, it is coming out to some 6,739 crores for them. That is their total revenue purely from the pharma business, purely from their core business. This is what is their revenue. Now, there is one part called other income, which is other revenue source. What is this other revenue source? Most of the companies, what they do is, just like you and I invest somewhere to earn some extra returns, the companies also, they do some kind of investments either in some other companies or buy some mutual funds, buy some bonds, just like an individual is doing. Even the company also does if it has some excess cash. Right? Why to keep the cash idle? Probably if we do some kind of investments, there is a possibility that the returns could be slightly higher. So which could result in some kind of income. Which means, let's say if they have invested in some shares of some other company, they'll get dividends. So whatever was the dividend for that year, we call it as dividend income. Similarly, if they have bonds of some other companies, they will get some kind of interest. If they have done some fixed deposit somewhere, they'll get some interest. So all that interest is for that year. Right? So the interest for that year, the dividend for that year, they are all treated as a part of other income. Now if you see, they have expanded that other income also here. You see, other income, the details given in 2.17, they said interest income on fixed deposits. They did some fixed deposits. They got almost 30 crores of interest on the fixed deposits which they have done. The interest is 30 crores. Right? And similarly, on loans to subsidiaries. Oh, they have some other subsidiaries. Dr. Reddy's is having a couple of other subsidiaries. Is nothing but, this is a parent company. It has invested in some other company. Right? But that's a separate company. But this company has invested heavily in that. Probably it's like IBM US, IBM India. IBM India is a subsidiary of IBM US. Or in some cases, some companies are held like that. What does that mean is, the parent, it has invested in a company in India. It is treated as a separate company, IBM India Private Limited. That could be the name, right? That could be the name of the company, which means in India, it's a private limited company. But IBM parent has invested in this company. Right? So, if it has, sometimes what happens is, instead of investment, it can give loan. Investment is, it's like a capital. Whatever the profits that come here, that portion of the profit will go to that company in the form of a dividend. Whereas if it has given it in the form of a loan, every year, this company has to pay some interest to that company. So though everything is IBM itself, the way it is invested, right, will fetch the revenues for that parent company. So that is what here it is, on loans to the subsidiaries. It must have given some kind of loan to the various companies. Probably Dr. Reddy's India, it has invested in Dr. Reddy's US. It has given some kind of loan for operating there, or some other Middle East, somewhere else, wherever they must be operating. So it's not a perfect branch of this. It is running as a separate company there. If IBM India, there is no company called IBM India Private Limited, even if this is completely a part of IBM US, you will not have the name as IBM India Private Limited. You will only have the name called IBM. Whatever the name which a US guy calls it as, that's the same name for an Indian operations also. if there is a different name that has come out for the Indian operations, means in India it is registered separately. And so it's a different company altogether. But from a funding perspective, the entire funding is coming from IBM US itself. So it's again like this only. If this goes into a loss, only this much portion is lost out. So that's where it is registered as a separate company. So because of that, there could be some advantages that are associated. Right? So that's where they prefer not floating everywhere as only IBM. They will always float it as separate companies in different geographies. And they say we have invested in those companies. So probably if at all IBM India requires some loan, and if IBM US is having some spare capital with it, it can very well say we can give you the loan. You pay us this much of an interest. Because at the end, every company is separate. Though internal, but transaction is, it's a separate transaction. So that's where this has happened here. And they have done some other deposits. So, just like any other individual, the companies also will do a lot of investment. And how much of investment they have done, that will be in the balance sheet because it's an asset for them. Every investment that they have made, they can sell off those investments at a later point and they can get the cash back. So, any investment the company has done is an asset itself. Now, if I want to see how much investment they have done, you look at the balance sheet. Non-current, actually the word balance sheet, in balance sheet, current means short term. 1 year. Short term investments, which means they mature in the next 1 year. The maturity of them will be in the next 1 year. They are all current investment, which means 207 crores like FDs or something, they are going to mature within the next 1 year. Anywhere within the next 1 year. Whereas for long term, 5 year bonds, or probably if I have invested in a subsidiary, I will not pull out the investment within 1 year, right? Let's say IBM has invested in IBM India. It is for a longer term investment. Probably for few years it will continue its investment. It's not that at the end of the year it is pulling back the money. Then there is no IBM India anymore. So from that standpoint, wherever it is for a longer term, more than 1 year, we call them as non-current. If it is for less than 1 year, we call them as current. So probably a fixed deposit or probably a normal deposits with a bank may be treated as current. Or any FD maturing in the next 6 months. That is current, right? Within the next 1 year, anything that is maturing off, we'll treat it as current. Anything that is maturing or that will be sold only after 1 year, they are all non-current. So here you can say that this company is having almost 2,270 crores of non-current investments, right? So they have invested almost 2,270 crores. In various other investments, not in the pharma business or not in Dr. Reddy's. They have invested 2,270 crores outside Dr. Reddy's. Because they have invested that, they are getting some they have invested in the form of loan, some they have given in the form of capital. If they have given in the form of capital, they are getting some dividend. If they have given in the form of loan, they are getting some interest. So that is what was the other income. So for the 2,200 crores which they have invested, they got some returns of 81 crores in this year. Right? So that is what is the other income. So the total revenue, now when you look at all these, so this is the total revenue of the company. Again, this also may be paid, may not be paid. Cash wise, don't look at it. For this year, let's say I know the interest every year. Let's say I have given the loan and I say I am giving you the loan at 10% interest. Every year you have to pay me 10%. So on a 100 crore loan which I have given to you, I know that I have to get 10 crores. So 10 crores is what I'll put as an income. Doesn't matter whether I have received it or not. You have to be careful about this aspect. The 10 crores is applicable for that year. Whether I receive it this year or I receive it next year, immaterial. I will write it as 10. If I have received it, transaction is over. Nothing goes in the balance sheet. If I haven't received it, something is still outstanding in that transaction. So the transaction is shown in the P&L. If it is still outstanding, it goes as an entry in the balance sheet also. If it is not outstanding, over. Right? Every transaction, whether it is your purchase transaction or a selling transaction, whatever it is. Right? Whatever is for that period, it comes into the P&L. If you have got the cash for it, fair enough. No, nothing goes into the balance sheet. If you are still to receive something more out of it, that something more will go into the balance sheet. So the total revenue of the company is 6,821 crores. So this is exclusively for the company. Whereas this is all others put together. This is like a gross turnover of the company. Which includes even the other income sources also. Is only respected to sales, only the selling of the products, turnover only with respect to sales, whereas this is overall turnover of the company, because they have some other sources of income also, not just the sale. For some companies, it may be just the sales which is their overall. They may not do any service, they may not be any other operating revenues. Those all might not be there for many of the companies. Right, so other income may still be there for almost all the companies. The reason being, other income is a very integral part of every business. Every business invests somewhere outside their normal business. Right, it's not mandatory, because see, sometimes I have cash. But at the same time, I cannot invest everything in my business. Because the only based on the growth potential I can invest, right? Even though I have 1,000 crores with me. But if I think that the potential is not more than another 5% more than the previous year. Or 10% more than the previous year. See, it doesn't mean that I have so much of capital means I can do a big business. It all depends on the market. How many units I can sell. Only based on how many units I can sell, I will think of how many units I have to produce, and to produce how much capital I require. It doesn't, it does not go, it may not, it need not go with how much capital I have. Right? I may be having more capital, I may be having less capital. If I am having less capital, probably I may borrow or I may raise from various other sources. If I am having more capital, probably I may invest it anywhere else. Right? Otherwise, see, I have a capital. Let's say all of you have funded me and I got 1,000 crores. But suddenly, just because I have 1,000 crores, if I buy everything left and right, buildings, blah, 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 all kinds of stuff. Right? For the business only. For the business only, let's say I buy all that stuff. Everything may or may not turn out into revenues. This building, I bought it, but it's of no use. I bought three buildings in one go, thinking that I require 1,000 people. But I could recruit only 300 people. Then the two buildings are unnecessarily waste itself. And they are not fetching me anything also, because I may not have given it them on rental basis also. Right? These are the waste usages of the assets. So what the companies typically do is, if at all it is having more and more cash, instead of unnecessarily investing in the business where the potential may not be beyond a certain extent, see, it has still grown by this much. It might not have grown by more. It's just because I have more money, I cannot grow my business overnight. It doesn't mean that if I have 1 lakh crores with me, I can grow my business to anything. Right? So there is only some kind of a potential for that business. So that is what is being coming out here. So that's where every company will think of investing somewhere else also apart from their core business. Right? Here, whenever we are talking about a P&L statement and a balance sheet, P&L statement is for that full year. Whereas the balance sheet is as of that date, as on 31st March. As on 31st March 2012, I still did not receive this much money. Though I have sold, probably it must be a credit sale. Right, there is still some credit period that is involved. So I may receive it in the first week or second week of April. Right, but as far as the sales is concerned, it's over. Right, so in the P&L statement, the sales has nothing to do with the cash. So whenever we are preparing a P&L statement, simple thing is never bother about whether you have received the cash for it or not. So even when you are projecting a P&L, probably the best way for you to make a P&L is assume everything is a cash transaction and make it. Assume everything is a cash transaction and you make it. So which means all entries are being made. No advance payments. Payment as of that period. You assume everything is like that. Your P&L is ready. Probably you assume everything is sold. Think of like everything you got in the form of cash. Right? That is what will make your P&L. Because in reality, the credit... So if at all, or the other better way for me to put is, if at all, there is no credit angle at all in the business, then my P&L statement is same as my cash itself. Right, wherever there is some kind of a credit angle coming up, because on all these accounts, there may be still something that is outstanding. As on the 31st March, there must be something that is outstanding. And that outstanding is what we are representing in the balance sheet. Okay, now the same way, for majority of the expenses also, there are some standard headings. Cost of materials consumed, which is typically called as your cost of goods sold. Why are we are not calling it as purchases here? One important thing. Raw material purchase is not the word that is used. They are called as cost of goods consumed, cost of goods sold. They are the typical words for it. The reason being, let's say you have sold 1,000 units, 1,000 quantity, right? You will write the cost corresponding only to this 1,000 quantity. Though your production department, your manufacturing department, let's say they have produced 1,100 units. Let's assume bikes. 1,100 bikes are already manufactured. But in this year, you were able to sell only 1,000 of them, which means remaining 100 bikes are in your godown. Simple. Right? If that is the case, even the cost of production, you will show only for those 1,000 only. Though you have produced 1,100, the cost which you are showing here is only for that 1,000. Right? That is what is the typical concept of cost. Because you have already incurred for 1,100. Your cost has already been incurred for 1,100 because you have manufactured all 1,100. But you could not sell them. Or you may sell them probably in April next year. But as of today, you did not sell them. Correct? If that's the case, it says, this is a typical concept in again in accounting called matching concept. You match your expenses with your revenues. Your revenues are coming only for 1,000 goods. So your expenses also should be for that 1,000 goods only. Consumed for selling those goods. Consumed for the goods that are sold. Cost of goods which are sold. I sold 1,000 goods. The cost, how much did it cost for the company for those 1,000? Only the sold ones. So, sometimes production may produce more also or less also, right? It is not the matter. Whether they have produced more or, sometimes what they may do, they say, already 500 are there in the stock. So, this year let's produce only 600. But still you are able to sell 11,000 because 500 from the last year's stock, and probably 500 from the current year production. You'll take the 1,000 and you are selling. So even when you are putting the cost also, you'll not put the cost of the 600 which you have produced. You'll put the cost for the 1,000 because you have not included those 500 in the last year cost. Right? You did not include that 500 in the last year's cost. So it's a matching. Whatever the revenues, whatever the number of units you are selling, the cost associated, this is typically called as a matching concept. Every expense. For the 1,000, need not be the case, right? So, every cost, whether it is a trading cost or the material consumption, raw materials cost, everything is in line with the number of goods that are typically sold. Right? So, even in your budget, when we do a budget exercise, all these things will become clear. I'll give you a case study before you leave for the day. So, just you can go through that case and we will actually make the budget, a real-time budget tomorrow. So, all these fundamentals will be taken care of when we are preparing that. Alright. Then, employee benefit. As I said, last year, it was 727 crores. This year, it was 866 crores. So, probably the employee benefit has increased by some part. So, as an analyst, your role is seeing, okay, did the cost go up? By how much extent did the employee expense go up? For this company, for the competitors, this is a typical analysis which people do. Okay, materials cost or revenues, by what extent did they go up? A typical analysis. The revenues, by what extent did they go up? I'll take the percentage increase. Right, from last year to this year, there was a 27% growth in the revenues. Now, I will see, okay, competitors are also there. They are growing like this only. Or some of them grew lesser, some of them grew higher, what it is. Same thing I'll say, okay, employee expenses. I will take the same scenario. Right, this minus this divided by this. I've increased my employee expenses just by 19%. Right, the employee expenses have grown by 19%. But the revenue has grown by 27%. Which means by paying slightly excess to my employees, probably a better logic, by paying a bit excess to my employees, I have increased the revenues more. Which means probably the output per employee is actually increasing. The employee cost increased only by 19%. The hike was, let's say, around 19%, whatever it is. It need not be hike because new employees recruited, all that could be there. But assuming the hike, by paying some 19% more, to the employees. It has resulted in a 27% growth of the revenues, which is like a good sign. Probably if you have spent more on the employees but your revenues have come down, then probably this company's efficiency is actually going down. Utilizing the employees to generate more sales, it is going down. Because both of them are for that year only. Sales is, revenues is also for that year. Employee expense is also for that year. Whether they pay it or not, probably we can keep that aside. That will be shown in balance sheet and cash flow statement. The reality is what? Whereas as far as what is incurred for them is shown in the P&L. So these kind of analysis I can make. Okay, what has happened to my materials? Did the materials grow more than the revenues which I have got? This minus this divided by this. If you see here, 30.2. Which means the costs have gone up more than the revenues. For the company, the costs have gone up more than the revenues. So probably there is a possibility that the profits may come down. But of course, they have managed it in other areas. So that might result in the profit slightly going up. You see here, the overall profit of the company, the overall profit of the company will come there. The overall profit of the company has grown only by 2%. From last year, though the revenues they have grown by 27%, but the profit has increased just by 2%. Which means some other costs have actually grown much higher compared to their revenues. Right? Otherwise, the profit also would have grown up much higher. Because something else, see, like the materials cost has gone up higher. Though the employee cost has gone up, it's not that high. Now, the finance costs have gone up very much higher. What are these finance costs? Finance costs are to do with the interest. Interest which the company is paying on the loans which it has taken. Which is an indicator for me, probably they have taken a new loan in this year. Suddenly from 5 crores, the interest, finance cost is nothing but the interest. Interest of 5 crores in the last year, it's not about payment, right? It's about incurring. So the interest for the last year was only 5 crores, whereas for this year it is 63 crores. The only way it is possible is, I might have taken a new loan in this year. Right? Some heavy loan must have been taken, which has what has contributed to some extra interest expense. Now, if I go back, so that loan is a liability. That loan should be a liability, whatever the amount I have borrowed, because I will be settling it probably sometime later. So, I have to look at in my liabilities. In long term, they did not take. Short term, there was a small increase. So, the loan, there was an increase. Earlier, last year, the loan was around 930 crores. This year, it has become 1020 crores, which is almost 90 crores they have borrowed. Right? As of last year, the total loan was 930 crores. Loan that was outstanding. Outstanding loan was 930 crores. Now the outstanding loan has become 1020 crores. Almost 90 crores was an excess borrowing. Right? So by looking at these kind of things, we can very well assess whether something has gone up or gone down during the period. So the interest expense has gone up for the company drastically during the period. And look at other. This is where. Okay, I'll come back to this depreciation part. Then, if you see the major headings, now let's see the major headings. First, raw materials and cost of goods consumed, which is more to do with the raw materials and all that. That is one expense, one major expense. The second major expense is employees. The employees' salaries, that's a big category. That's the second. The third group is finance. right? The total expenses of the company for the year, these are the major headings which IFRS suggests that they have to come into. All the materials related. Materials related, they made it very clear. How many goods you have sold? Based on those many goods, whatever have sold, what was the expense of production for that? Whether you have produced more than that or less than that, you keep it with you. If you have produced more, keep it as assets. If you have produced less, keep it as liability. But of course, if you have produced less, you may not sell that much. But if you have produced more, obviously that can go as part of your inventory and as an asset. Okay. Now, the remaining thing is finance costs. Finance cost is typically the interest. That's also one expense for this year. Again, irrespective of payment, incurring is what we are typically looking at for the interest also. Then I'll come to the depreciation. The other is R&D. For this year, what is the R&D expense? This is a pharma company. So there's a lot of cost that goes into R&D. That's where this company has spent 581 crores in this year. This is not cumulative. For this year only. So P&L and balance sheet, you have to differentiate. P&L is exclusively for this year. Whatever the number that is being made. It's not that last year it was 512 crores, this year 580. So it doesn't mean that they have spent 60 crores extra for this year. They have spent 581 crores this year. Whereas in the balance sheet, we only talk about the balance for this year if I want to, because it's a cumulative figure. Whereas the P&L is exclusively for this year. Right? So this year they spent almost 581 crores on research. Now I can see, okay, what proportion of their revenues they spend on research. I can do all these calculations. Okay, this year 581 crores divided by probably 6,800 crores. As a proportion of their revenues, almost 8.5%. For every rupee which they are getting, they have spent 8.5 paisa on research. A typical analysis which you can put. Probably if I do the same thing for the previous year, this was the amount they have spent divided by this was their revenue. So last year they have put 9.4%. So for every rupee they have put almost 9.5 paisa on research. Whereas this year they have put 8.5 paisa only. So they have reduced their research cost. Overall it looks like their R&D expense has actually gone up. But for every rupee they have earned, their R&D costs have come down. So instead of looking at absolute numbers always, it may be worth to look at in percentage terms also, because that gives us a very better picture of the performance of the company. For every 1 rupee which you have put, so make it common. Whatever the rupee you have got, it may be 1,000 rupees here, 1,500 rupees there. But for every 1 rupee, for every 1 rupee which you have put, what is your typical expense? Now if I see this, let's say I talk about material. For every 1 rupee that is put, which means I can do this part, my materials are costing around 24% of my rupee. Whereas in this year, I'll say this divided by this, 25. So my materials are costing, the cost of the materials has actually gone up. From 24 paisa for every 1 rupee, they have gone up to 25.4 paisa. Now, if this is the case, I can compare the competitors also. Because now I am not looking at the volume of their business anymore. For every 1 rupee, which can be very much uniformized for everyone. So that kind of comparisons will make more and more effectiveness in our decision making. Similarly, employee costs. I can look at all of them. Right? On employees, am I spending more? Just quick comparison. Okay? On employees, 13.4% is spent on employees. For every rupee the company is getting, 13.4 paisa is spent on the employees itself. Is it high or low? That I cannot say in isolation. I have to always do a comparison. I may say yes. Then the next year they have reduced. Probably they have decreased their employee costs. Right? There are probably, I can say, they have increased their revenue more compared to the cost which they have spent on the employee. Probably the employee efficiency would have gone up. So those kind of analysis is what is typically being brought out just by looking at these financial statements. And the best way to analyze is express them as a percentage of the total revenue, which will give me a true picture of, for every 1 rupee of revenues which I am receiving, what is the typical expense that is being spent on various headings. So this is the R&D. Then other expenses is a very major item. 1512 crores, which means all the other things which are not related to material, labor, right, which is the employees, and interest, finance, rest all are R&D. Rest all are going into other, rent, power. You think of 200 items, travel. You see just what they talk about for that. Other expenses. You see the big list. Advertisement. They are spending almost 60 crores on advertisement. Last year, the previous year, they spent only 21 crores on advertisement, which means they are looking at advertising as a bigger role. Almost doubled their expenses on advertising, or more than that. Commission on sales. They have given almost 21 crores as commission to various medical representatives and all that. So you see, there are so many other selling expenses, power and fuel. You see, this is a very big cost. 177 crores is a power cost. So all these things, legal and professional, right? Probably you are paying some kind of, you have some lawyers and legal advice and all those expenses you are incurring. They are all going here. Traveling and conveyance, almost they have spent around 60 crores on travel and conveyance, various employees or whatever it is. The rentals of the various premises and all, 15 crores. The taxes and the rates which they have incurred, around 10 crores. Insurance premiums, around 12 crores. So you can see almost all the other expenses they have put up here. So probably the only way you can think of is anything which is very much striking with a big difference. This is something which you have to look at it as an alarming thing. Where it was probably zero in this year, suddenly it has gone up drastically. Let's say here, foreign exchange losses. 77 crores they have lost on foreign exchange. The earlier year they lost zero. Whereas this year they lost almost 77 crores on, or 78 crores on the foreign exchange. Because of the rupee fluctuations and all, they have lost almost 78 crores in the business. So if they have too much of overseas operations, these kind of heavy losses are very much possible. Right? Because as per the commitment, they may say, we will pay, or you have to, let's say if it is for their raw materials, getting some raw materials, let's say from US. At the time of the deal, they might have finalized the deal saying, we'll pay $100. So they might have, at the time when they have entered into the deal, they might have thought that $100 means probably 5,800 rupees at the rate of 58. They have a 1 month credit period. Right? So after 1 month, they have to make the payment. But by that time, $1 has become 60 rupees. So when they have actually entered into the contract, that was the time they have to write it in their P&L statement. When they have actually entered into the contract, that was the amount, 5.8. But today they have to pay 6. Because for the customer, for the vendor, it is $100. The deal is $100. It's not 5,800 rupees. If you pay 5,800 rupees, then probably he is receiving lesser than $100. But for him, you have to pay $100, which means you are incurring a loss of 200 rupees here, because 5,800 to 6,000. So because of foreign exchange fluctuation, sometimes you may gain. If it has become the same $100, if it has become 5,600 rupees, then you might have gained on it. Otherwise, you are losing on it. So all these kind of transactions, because of the foreign exchange rate fluctuations and all, some losses, some gains, they are all shown here. That those are all a part of your other expenses. So this company, these are the other expenses. And, okay, coming to this depreciation. As I said, any big capital investment the company has made, allocation of the cost. Right? If at all any investment is there which has a benefit of more than 1 year, that cost is allocated over the useful life of that particular asset. So they may be buying so many things, some building, if they have invested in a building. The building will have 30-40 years life. So whatever the cost they have spent on the building, they'll spread it over the 40 years. So for this year, only 1/40 of that cost will be shown as expense. The remaining, whatever is remaining, that goes into the asset. Getting it? Like that, all the various assets which they have, the proportion of the expenses, if I say vehicle, they may say that life is 5 years. See, these lives and all, they are some standardized numbers. For vehicle, for machine, there is a schedule 14 in the Indian Companies Act. It's a kind of a chapter 14. Chapter 14 of the Indian Companies Act, it specifies the percentages for each of the various, assets, how much you should take as percentage per each year, how much allocation you may have to do. You can do more aggressive than that, but you cannot do conservative on that. If the, let's say, the example there is, if I am going with the vehicle, right? If let's assume that the Companies Act is saying 10% per year, minimum. You have to depreciate. Depreciate is nothing but allocate the cost. You have to depreciate 10% per year. It means within 10 years, you have to spread the cost. Not more than that. Not more than that. If you want to do it lesser than that, it's up to you. Right? At the max, you can take 10 years to spread the cost. Not more than that. Because if you say my vehicle will give me 40 years of life, then what happens every year the expense is much, much lesser. Right? Suddenly the profits will always show higher only. Though that vehicle's life is over, but still you did not put the cost of the entire vehicle. Because every year you are showing only 1/40 of that cost. After 5 years, the vehicle itself is disposed. But still here your cost is not absorbed. So because of that, they have given some standard numbers. If you want to do it faster than that, it's up to you. Because if you do it faster, probably your profits are coming down. So only if a company wants to save some tax or something in the initial years, they'll do it faster. Because if they are doing it faster, expenses are going up. Because the whole spread is between 3 years itself instead of 10 years. They'll do the allocation of the whole cost within 3 years itself. So the expenses are showing much higher. Expenses are showing higher, the profits will come down. Profits come down, taxes will come down. They need not, see, if they want, they can dispose it. I mean, that should be the intention. But even if they don't dispose it, doesn't matter because their usage is, I mean, they have spread the whole cost. See, typically what they say is, please spread your costs in line with your usage. No, see, if you have spread all the costs, then that asset is zero. Asset value is zero, but you are using it. It's like you are using an asset whose value is zero, if you are still using it. Right? So that's where it is said that you please allocate your costs, just please spread your costs as per the usage. And be conservative. Don't be aggressive that my vehicle will last for 40 years. The accounting typically goes with another concept called conservatism. Don't be aggressive. As per the Schedule 14, there is some guidelines. So let's say a machine which is operating two shifts in a day. It says this much proportion has to be allocated. If you want, you do it more than that, but not less than that. You are doing more than that means you are feeling that, yeah, I will not have that much of life also. My machine is a slightly rougher machine. So probably within 3 years it will go off. So allocate the cost that way itself. Because the moment you dispose the machine, let's say after 5 years, thinking that it is a 10 year, you have initially started at 10% every year. After 5 years, you have disposed that machine. That entire 50%, whatever is there, that will go as an expense. Because at the end, or whatever is the balance which you did not allocate, let's say you started with 1 lakh. Every year, 10%, 50,000. 50,000 you have already allocated. For 5 years, 50,000 you have already allocated. And at the end of 5 years, your asset is 50,000. The remaining 50,000. Right? Let's say after the 5th year, you have disposed it off for 10,000. 40,000 you are showing it as a loss. Because as per your accounting books, you should sell off that machine, even if you are selling it off. You should sell it off for 50,000 bucks because that is the asset worth. You are showing that that is the worth of the asset. Right? That is the worth of the asset. Whereas when you have really sold it is only 10,000 bucks. Which means what you have lost 40,000 on that. Show it in the expense as a loss. Right? Loss because of selling of an asset. 40,000 is the loss. Right? So, yeah, that is what is the depreciation. So, if the depreciation is increasing, probably means the company is doing more and more capital purchases. Because more goods, on each good, some portion, overall it is getting piled up. So, probably if you are saying depreciation is 301 crores, look at their capital investment. The total capital investment is 1,896 crores. The total value of all their assets, all their tangible assets like buildings, vehicles, machines, plants, right, computers, whatever are there, land, whatever are there. The total worth of them is 1,896 crores. And for this year, the allocation is around 301 crore. Like that, if they keep purchasing, so because each one has its own life as per that schedule. So for each one, they will prepare a separate, if this is having 10 years' life, so the numbers are prepared for the 10 years. If this is having a 15 years' life, the cost is spread for 15 years. Now, for each year, they will do the add-up. In the next year, again, something new purchase. From that year to some other years, again, a 12-year schedule is being prepared. So, all this for that particular year, they are pulled up and put as one depreciation heading. And similarly, the other thing is provision. New machine is for 12 years. Example. If another machine is having a life of 12 years, you just spread it out. So what could happen? Let's say this year they have purchased something for 10 lakhs with a 5-year life. So what they are putting, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2 is what is put. Another machine is purchased with let's say 20 lakhs with 10 years life. So it is again like 2, 2, 2, 2 for 10 years useful life, which means 10% per year. Let's say in the same year. They have purchased it in the same year. So what will happen? As per this purchase, the depreciation for the for this year is 4 lakhs. And probably for the next 4 years is also 4 lakhs. And after that it is 2 lakhs. Now let's say next year, they have purchased another asset. Third asset in the second year. They have purchased another asset worth 30 lakhs. Some building or something. Which is having only 5 years life. So which means here they will put 6, 6, 6, 6, 6 for 5 years. Which means in the second year their P&L will show 10 lakhs as the depreciation. Right? Now again, as we move, whenever they are purchasing. So now let's say here they have come up to this year. In this year they have purchased another thing with 10 lakhs. Where only 2 years life. So here they will put a 5, here they will put a 5. In this year, earlier it was only 2 lakhs. So for this year, they will write the depreciation as 7 lakhs. Again, probably in this year, it's only 2 lakhs. Because they have already allocated fully all the other assets. Only this asset is pending as of this year. This is the depreciation. No, generally companies keep purchasing new assets. It's not that one time they purchase. See, if they have purchased some machine here, after 5 years, it is gone. Now they have to purchase one more machine, right? Otherwise, their business will get impacted. So, probably there will be one more purchase here. One more purchase here means the depreciation again may start going up. Because for that again they have to depreciate. So some need or the other keeps coming across the course of the business. See, everything has its own expiry, right? Right? You have bought a car, you have bought few vehicles. Few years they are fine. After that you have to replace them. Replacing means again you are incurring a new cost. And again they're based on their life, you are allocating that. So a depreciation is again coming up. See, it's only notionally. And then one more aspect that we are looking at here is provisions. The depreciation is a word for tangible assets. Spreading the cost for a tangible asset we call as depreciation. Spreading the cost for intangible assets we call as amortization. Let's say patent. That cannot be touched, right? Patent. You have paid something to get a patent. But that patent is for, let's say, 5-year period. It's like you have purchased a patent. It's an intangible. Let's say software. You have purchased a software which will have a life for 5 years. Let's say license or whatever you call it. There is a life of it for 5 years. Then what you are doing, that cost of the software, you are spreading for 5 years. Whatever is the cost that is associated, that whatever is the allocation that you are doing for intangible assets, we call that as amortization. For a tangible one, we call it as depreciation. Otherwise, both are one and the same. Only the breakup is between tangible and intangible. So that's where here also we club it and show as one single. But in the details, you can see if I go to their annual report here, they'll show everything. So probably you should take some time to just go through this. You see this? Probably they have mentioned it in the other way. The tangible assets. They are calling land, buildings, plant and machinery, electrical equipment, laboratory equipment, because these all will have life of more than 1 year. They have invested in that. And if you see what all they have invested, what is their major? This is their major amount. 1,461 crores. And even in the current year, they have invested 272 crores. In what? Plant and machinery. They have invested newly 272 crores in plant and machinery. So their overall in plant and machinery itself is 1,721 crores of investment. Out of that 1,800 or out of that whatever we call 3,300 crores overall, you are seeing that 1,720 crores is purely in plant and machinery itself. The same way you can look at probably their investments are higher in laboratory equipment. So, and these are the intangibles. Now you see customer contracts, technical know-how, 45 crores. It's like a patent. They have invested 45 crores in the patent. And similarly, the non-competence piece, making sure that no one, I mean, to make sure no one manufactures that drug for next 1 year or 2 years. They have paid 22 crores for that. Right? So, those are like, they have paid it not as per that year, but for the next couple of years. So, if they have paid only for 2 years or 3 years, the 22 crores will be allocated in 2 years as amortization. 11 crores for 2 years. Then we are also looking at provisions. Provisions are something, especially the company will declare for that year, but it is sure that it will pay in the next year. Like dividend. Dividend is based on the profits of this year. But it cannot pay it in this year because only after it computes the profit, which would be computed only on 31st March. Only after it computes the profit, it will pay the dividend, which will definitely be paid only in the next year. So, whatever are those items, which the company is very much sure that it will pay in the next year only, but they are incurred for that year, it will call them as provision. It has set a provision that it will pay dividend for this much. Because it is always a liability only. If you look at it as of 31st March, because it cannot compute the dividend as on that day, before that. Right? So that's where those kind of things are handled as a part of the provision, which means there will be an entry in the balance sheet also corresponding to the provision. Because they have yet to pay. Right, so they are handling it in a P&L also as a separate expense, like dividends and all. So whatever they think, they are very much reasonable of paying, but it will be paid in the next year itself. They are all handled as a part of provision. And so based on all these things, the total expenses are computed for the company. The difference between the two is what they call as profit before tax. Total revenues, total expense, that is the total profit. On this, a tax is what is levied. The current year's tax based on this profit is this much. There is a deferred tax. We'll talk about this deferred tax in more detail when we talk about the balance sheet. But typically, it is like the tax that was corresponding to the previous years. If they have paid more in the previous years, it's like they are paying lesser this year, right? More than what they actually have to pay. It's a kind of reversing. If they have paid lesser than what they have to pay, why that more or less will come, I'll discuss when I'm talking about in the balance sheet. So if they have paid lesser, probably it's like they have to pay more for this year. If they have paid more, it gets as a reversal. So, this is what is the tax. So, the total tax they are paying for this year exclusive, this is what it is. the previous year's impact is a negative, which means they must have paid more in the previous year, which is coming out as a negative thing for them. So overall, after the payment of tax, this is what is their profit. So they have actually paid slightly more tax for this year for whatever reason. So overall profit after the tax for them is 912 crores. So now, and out of this 912 crores, they have declared a dividend of 221 crores. What did they do with the remaining? The remaining 690 crores, they have invested as additional capital into the business. See, generally, how can the business grow? Every year, I cannot keep taking loans, right? If I have to grow my business, I need more capital. Where can I get the capital? I cannot always see it's only internally generated capital which is more and more beneficial, not the external capital. Right? Internal capital for me is more like, yeah, my shareholders, my investors, they are fine taking 221 crores. Right? And they are fine. It's their money. It's like they have contributing something more to my business. If more profits come in the future because of more growth, they'll get a big share of money. Right? So, that is what is the concept of dividend, and the this is actually called as retained earnings, because the retained profits or retained earnings is the better name for it, which is more like the profit you are retaining to invest it back into the business. So 690 crores is an additional capital without borrowing, without any external source, within internal itself. So you can grow by another 690 crores. You can grow your business. You can increase your sales. You can increase your production. Now you have more capital available compared to the previous year. That's how a company grows. The major part of the contribution to the growth of the company is the internal capital, which comes after your from your operations. This is completely the operations of the company. These are the revenues. These are the expenses. Overall, you have generated this much of profit as per the books. This need not be your cash position. Always mind it. This is as per the books. This is the profit. Out of this, this is the tax you are supposed to pay. So this is your final profit. And out of the final profit, you have paid this much as a dividend, which means this much of cash or this much of profit is again retained back as additional capital into the business. So what you will see is the additional capital in the business, which is again a part of the balance sheet, that will grow by that much. You see here from 5,935 crores last year, the total capital, it has gone to 6,626 crores. It was an increase by that 6,800 crores. The 690 crores is like additional capital that came into the business. So, because in the balance sheet, we talk about accumulation. Last year, until the last year, the capital was 5,935 crores. To that, you add another 600 crores. It will make it 6,626 crores. So, whatever is it means, the capital that is available in the company, the capital that is available with the company is around 6,626 crores. Now, with that, they will do various kinds of purchases and lot of other things. It will come under the liabilities because the company has to pay, because company is an independent entity, as I said. The capital is given by someone else. Even the owner has given something to it. Right? The into Dr. Reddy's as a company, probably Anji Reddy and his family has given some capital. You have given some capital. I have given some capital. Everyone has given some capital. Right? So, that capital, whatever profits come, The company has to give that entire profit to all of us, to Anjireddy and family and to all of us, based on that proportion of our investment. But the company is not doing that. Company is giving only some portion of the profit to all of us. The remaining portion, it is saying as if you all have, I have given, the company has given all of you your share, and again all of you have given back to the company some portion of it. It's like all of you have invested again with the company. Extra capital you have pumped in into the company. So it does not, I mean, the physical route is not like that, but the virtual route is like that. Physical route is, company will say, we'll only declare this much as a dividend and we are retaining the remaining part. Virtually, it means I'm giving all of you your dividend, your share of the profit, and you again lend back that much amount. So, which means new capital has come in into the company. It's a liability from a company standpoint. It has to pay to all the investors. Right? So, that is what is the P&L statement. So, probably the moment you look at two or three companies' P&L statement, you can very well assess the performance of each of those companies. Are they doing so? The format will be the same for any company. Probably those specific to pharma sector like license fee, these kind of things may not be there. Service fee, these kind of things may not be there for all the companies. Right? But others, especially cost of goods consumed and sold, the employee expenses, probably R&D may exist for some of them, may not exist. So whichever are not existing, they are omitted. But otherwise, other expenses will definitely be there for everyone, which will be all those big lot, rent, marketing, advertising, all that stuff. Finance costs may exist for every company which has taken loans. Tax. This is a typical format of any P&L statement. So, once you are looking at the final profit after tax and dividend, you can see how much capital is flowed back into the company for the next year. And at the same time, how much dividend is being paid? Is the profit of the company growing consistently? Or profit is what portion of the sales? One thing which I can look at is the profit margin, typically is a very common word that is being used, which is nothing but this divided by your total revenue. For every 1 rupee of sales which you have, 1 rupee of revenue which you are getting, what is your profit? So the profit percentage is 16% last year, whereas this year the profit percentage is 13.3%. So company has the profits of the company has fallen compared to the last year. On an absolute scale, they might have increased, but on a percentage scale, they have fallen. Sorry, this is a profit margin, which is nothing but profit per 1 rupee of revenues. So profit divided by the revenue. So for every 1 rupee of sale which they are doing, 1 rupee of revenue which they are getting, 16 paisa is the profit, which means 84 paisa were there, all expenses. All expenses put together is 84 paisa. All expenses including tax. All expenses put together was 84 paisa. So 16 paisa was their profit. Whereas in the next year, in the current year, it was only 13 paisa which is their profit. So probably their total expenses for every 1 rupee of revenue which they are getting, their expenses have gone up by 3 rupees. Profits have gone down by 3 rupees, which is 3 paisa, which is a slightly... I mean, see here, every percentage or even every minute percentage is an important aspect. Probably even going down by half a paisa or a quarter paisa is also a very serious thing. Because if your profits are going down, your dividends may go down. So your dividends may go down means your investors' perception of the company will go down. The stock price may come down. They keep selling their shares. Because they not invest means... it's nothing but you sell off your share. Selling off the shares means obviously the more sales happening, which is more supply, less demand. Less buyings, more selling is as good as more supply, less demand. Price will come down. So that is where you have to make sure that the, so most of the accounting scams, what they do is they try to keep this number always higher. They do all kinds of manipulations in only these items. Right? It's manipulation again, not to be caught. Right? It's not that cheap manipulation. Today, sophisticated manipulations happen. Right? Probably the accountant himself will structure it in a very advanced manner. That whatever are the loopholes that are there in the accounting standards, they try to use those loopholes and try to adjust the numbers. So because once this number is higher, whether it is a Satyam scam or whatever are the scams, the intention was this number was kept always higher. Because as long as this number is keeping on growing, investors think that the company is doing very well. They keep buying shares and shares in the market. The stock prices keep going up. Right? So, nutshell, this is what is on the income statement of the company. As a simple suggestion, you can take any income statement of your company itself or any company that is your choice. If it is listed on any one single stock exchange, you will get its annual report published on the net. You just pick up that annual report. You can just put it in simple spreadsheet like this. Do some kind of comparison. At what rate did they grow? Right? We'll do some ratio analysis also towards the end. Some common kinds of analysis which you can do on the financial statement. Once we complete our understanding of the balance sheet and the cash flow statement also, we'll do some basic analysis on what can be done on the things to analyze, okay, profitability wise, what is happening with the company? Efficiency wise, what is happening with the company? So from 3-4 dimensions, if I have to look at the performance of the company, how will I look at is what we'll do in the, once we are done with these three statements understanding process. All right.